goes too far in terms of vitiating the rights of individuals. Is there a possibility, if you were in a state in which both parties have to consent to the use of a taping mechanism, that this will violate local laws? Because the states are divided pretty evenly between one and two party states. So
right. So that's an issue that we were looking at pretty extensively when we were formulating the legal portion of this presentation. We really had a hard time finding any specific laws that the product violates. But it's our position that it would be up to an individual business and an individual to determine the legality and the use of this product. But I would make the point that you were talking about the value of increasing transparency in the workplace. And I feel like what you were saying about like creating work means that there's going to be a significant
increase in caseload.
Yes, exactly. But I would argue that this next step along the line of technological transparency actually would significantly benefit workers and employers, because I think that accountability is always a good thing, and transparency is always a good thing, right?
Okay, so taking accountability, my husband's doctor.
Right.
The notion that a surgeon's communicating with other doctors when they're operating, where the insurance company only gets to pay the one who's actually doing the cutting, it just doesn't happen in today's world, except
right.
maybe in a residency training. But if a patient walks into a consultation with a doctor, and the doctor knows that every single word he says to the patient is being taped, right? Because the patient has made a motion or whatever,
well,
or tapped it, then you're creating a record for a malpractice case per se. What level of imposition is that going to put on the course of the conduct of every kind of business, whether you're the employer or you're the doctor or any business person dealing with a consumer in a workplace? And have you taken that into account as an issue?
Yeah, I would just like to point out places where there is an expectation of privacy and where there isn't an expectation of privacy. And
is there an expectation of privacy in the workplace?
Well, that would be up to the workplace to decide.
But is it up to the law to decide whether there's an expectation of privacy in the workplace or not?
Well, the law in some circumstances, but then you could have specific circumstances where privacy is expected. For instance, like you're describing here, a doctor talking to a patient one-on-one. The doctor could very well not allow products like glass.
How could he do that if glass doesn't violate the law and the patient comes in wearing glass and he has no idea, one party can set a state of whether the party has activated glass? Because I mean, I wear glasses most of the time and I can envision that this is ultimately going to be connected to your corrective lenses. How would the doctor even know that it's been turned on? And in a state like New York where only one person has to consent, the patient consents by turning it on and the doctor says, I really don't want glasses if I need my glasses.
But isn't that
on?
No different than currently with your cell phone? I could tape conversations right. with my cell phone.
But to
right
tape
now,
a conversation generally with a cell phone, there's a limited amount you can tape
right.
and it's in your pocket, and there are issues. We've had issues in court about the admissibility of the cell phone audio
right.
because you can't tell when it's been taped necessarily, and if
and
it goes on
visual with
you
it.
Don't have the visual with it, and you can't tell whether it's been altered.
Right. One thing I would like to point out is that in California, an illegally recorded or a privately recorded, or I guess a better word is covertly recorded conversation isn't permissible in court, period. California has an explicit law against recording conversations and using them in court.
And it's a very rare state that does that.
Right. But when we're talking about using glass compared to using smartphone technology, it's worth pointing out the limitations that you were talking about smartphones, about how they have limited recording capacity and limited features.
Uh-huh.
It would be significantly easier to record an entire conversation with a doctor with a phone set to record in my pocket rather than using glass, because glass has a visual indicator of when it's recording at all times.
Or with a tool specifically designed
could I
for,
see
for
it
spying.
As the other party?
Yes,
I
yeah,
know.
And there's a red light that comes on. I may have failed to mention that, but when there is recording, and then also, as we have recommended, a sliding plastic shield. But this product, if someone wanted to do that and record conversations with other people, this is not the right product. This product is not intended for that, and it would not be effective at achieving that goal.
Is there anything that would stop somebody from altering the product the way that people alter their smartphones and unlock them after the fact so that the light will go on? To the best of your knowledge?
That's definitely something that we've looked into, because we were especially concerned about privacy. Obviously, that was the central theme of this presentation. But what allowed us to make the final recommendation that it is justifiable is that Google has done significantly more than other companies to make it explicitly clear when this product is utilizing its recording capabilities. And that far exceeds industry standards. And when we're talking about something like recording a conversation and using it in court, it's not a significant fear that people would be using glass and there would be like backlash over the admissibility of it, because wouldn't there be more backlash if somebody was using a secret tape recorder? Because glass isn't particularly secret. It's highly conspicuous, and they've gone to great lengths to ensure that people who are in the field of recording are aware of that.
Now, when you record with glass, it doesn't record the individual. You would not see the face of the individual who's wearing glass, only the other party, or can it,
yes,
can
correct.
It show both?
Just
one direction.
Correct.
Sylvia, did you have a question?
Yes. Okay, listening to what she has to say, okay, and all of you in college, you know how people can get into your Facebook, no matter what you think, and look at what you're doing that will affect either you get into college or you get a job. Now, what if one of your friends at a party or somewhere, it doesn't have to be a party, uses that in the pictures and then posts them on his Facebook, or post them with you tagged, and then other people see them, how is that gonna, and that may affect your ability to get a job anymore. Do you understand what I mean?
Okay, yes.
Because they just take pictures, and you're saying that's autonomous, and it's up to the person to be legal about it, but how many college kids are gonna be legal about it when they wanna do, show off their, you know, when they really wanna get after somebody? They think it's still, I mean, you know, my nephew showed pictures of them throwing a mattress out of the fraternity house at Berkeley, sliding down it. You know, that other people could have looked at if they were, you know, family members, whatever. So, and they could have showed it to somebody else. So what is the legality, you know, what's going on with that?
I think our argument would be that it's not, there's no intrinsic feature of glass that makes it especially good to do that, and that technology to do that already exists. And also that basically the person who actually does the act is the person who's responsible for it.
And one of the things that Rory pointed out in this presentation when we brought up the point about Facebook and Twitter, this is a particularly relevant concern. And I understand, because going to a city college, we're all concerned about transferring. But it's true, but the reality is that glass isn't a significant step forward in terms of the capabilities to take pictures and tag. If I wanted to right now, I could pull out my iPhone and take a picture of my teammates here and tag all of them and post it to their walls, technically without their consent. And Google Glass is not a step further necessarily along this, transparency. Rather, it makes it more user-friendly to the person who's wearing it. And people who are in the line of sight of a picture being taken with Google Glass would be able to be notified of that picture being taken, whereas if I pulled out my iPhone right now, if my phone was on silent, none of them would even know that I had taken a picture.
I would just like to refer back to our analogy of someone using a chair, right? If I throw the chair at someone and I hurt them, it's not really the fault of the chair company, but it's the fault of the autonomous individual who decided to engage in that action.
I think it's important also to emphasize the privacy settings again. Even if that person posts that picture, you still have the possibility of taking yourself off from that tag.
No, you can't on Twitter. You can't do that on Twitter. You can't take yourself off.
Now, you didn't think that there was a risk because the chair thrower or user, what came to mind immediately was Clint Eastwood, but what the person involved with the chair is the one who's likely to be sued for throwing the chair, correct? But in reality, what happens in the court system is that you look for the person with the deepest pockets possible. So if the person who's doing the recording is a college kid whose parents happen happens to have no money, and he's on a scholarship somewhere, suing him isn't going to get a plaintiff very much. Trying to join Google and sue Google for whatever they did in creating this product is a minefield for plaintiff's counsel. Plaintiff counsel are like bloodhounds smelling blood, okay? Do you perceive, since we're supposed to be Google's, leadership, have you researched the potential liability or the risk of class action lawsuits or collective action lawsuits being brought by people who have been videoed on Glass but who are looking for a very deep pocket to sue?
Well, as was said before, I feel like we're repeating ourselves, but Glass doesn't particularly, it's not really a step forward. Like, you remember the pivot head glasses, those are more conspicuous, and I guess what I'm trying to say is, if there were more viable options out there, would you really sell, or would you really sue Glass?
What are you doing
I understand
to mitigate the financial risks of that? What's your recommendation to us in terms of financial mitigation?
I think the most important thing that Google can do, because you're talking about covering your grounds, I mean, Google needs to take measures to protect themselves from people having the ability to sue them. And we fully understand this, but it seems that the best measure that Google could take to prevent lawsuits would be to implement measures that specifically make it so that if somebody decides to use this product to violate somebody's privacy, they're going beyond the roadblocks that Google has put in place based on the limitations of the product that would enable them to do so. Meaning that if you were using a picture that you took of somebody without their knowing it in an attempt to sue them, and it winded up to suing Google for the product being used for the picture taken, Google would argue that there was an obvious indication of that picture being taken. And if the person took efforts to conceal the fact that the picture was being taken, then Google's no longer liable because of those pictures.
Let me put it a different way. I don't have great vision when the room is dim. And if you were wearing glasses, a little light went off, and I was sitting over here, I might or might not be able to see it. There are also people who are colorblind, and I wanted to ask you, if it's a red light and they're colorblind, how would they even know that the light is on, for example?
Well, the fact that it's a red light doesn't diminish the fact that it's still a light. And if somebody was colorblind and a red light went off, they would still see a light. But what I would say to that, I guess, is the fact that
the product isn't completely finished yet, and as we recommended, Google could possibly integrate like a sliding plastic shield that makes it really explicit when the camera is not in use. You can completely cover the camera with just a small little plastic cover. That's one of our major recommendations.
Carl has a question. I'm just pushing it along because we're running out of time. So, Carl?
Your argument is the device is legal, it's the people that we can't trust. Robocallers are legal, it's the people we can't trust. Now there's companies who are creating countermeasures for robocallers to prevent them from calling. Do you envision that there could be a countermeasure devised for the glasses so that people in the vicinity can disable?
Well, in order for somebody to get the vicinity of Glass to disable it, as far as I know, technology doesn't exist right now to remotely and covertly disable somebody's device. And also, that would be, under the current laws, it would be illegal to forcefully deactivate somebody's device for fear of them using it to breach your privacy. But I guess what we keep coming back to is this notion that the device is so limited if you're attempting to use it for the means of malice in terms of breaching privacy. So I don't think it's necessarily a significant concern. I think phones have an obvious connection into people's homes, and that is an automatic breach of privacy because robocallers have this telecommunicative entrance into people's homes and into their lives. Glass is physically limited by the fact that somebody has to wear it and be standing outside of the vicinity and physically use this device in order to breach somebody's privacy. But even if they did that, the device itself is so limited to specific individual user function that it wouldn't necessarily make sense to do so. So to answer your question, I don't see specific measures coming out against this.
I have a question away from privacy, which is, so you touched on the distraction effect on drivers, right? Having this, I think the argument was that either more needs to be research needs to be done, or this limited visual field that's taken makes it okay. But isn't it really, it's not just that it's hands-free. It's not just that, I mean, it's a distraction, right? And it's actually, even if it's only that much, it's, so how do you justify supporting Google Glass for drivers and saying that it shouldn't just be banned when you're driving?
Well, our position is that we don't support Google Glass for drivers. Our stance is that a significant amount of research went into the laws that are currently implemented in 10 out of the 50 states that make it illegal to look down at your phone while you're driving. And the battle that went into passing that legislation, which has galvanized and increased popularity in other states, led to a justification of outlawing staring down at your cell phones. And no such research currently exists for a product that is transparent. However, we fully acknowledge that this product has more capabilities than just driving down the road and looking at directions. People have the ability to pull up videos or talk to their friends. And that's why Google hasn't specifically sanctioned its use for driving. We didn't get to show the video, but the most common use for the device while moving yourself is walking or riding a bicycle, which are instances in which it wouldn't be intrusive or dangerous. And we can't specifically say that we think it should be illegal for people to wear glass, because we don't think that it's our position as an advocacy group to state the intent of the law. Rather, our stance is that this device has obvious potential for distraction, and we think a significant amount of research needs to be done, but we acknowledge the potential for abuse, and we acknowledge the distracting capabilities, and we don't specifically condone its use for driving.
Thank you. Greg, do you have a question for us today?
Sorry,
I'm just not going to. We have about 3 minutes.
Okay, thank you. All right, so I'm sold on like the morally arbitrary nature of saying glass is bad, but cell phones are, you know, fine, whatever else. Happy hello on that one. I'm definitely not convinced that all objects are morally neutral in the same way, especially if we make a distinction between objects that are appearing naturally and those that are designed. Now, to try to backdoor in the idea of intention, brilliant. However, intention, as you guys know, is dubious. And so we have a question about access and intention. The autonomous individual, but also the society, because we don't live in some, you know, like uber libertarian quasi anarchy. I don't know, maybe if you go to IV and hang out there for a little bit. So here's my question. Should autonomous consumers have access to things like guns or bombs or nuclear technology? Because the moral linchpin boils down to intention in the same way that they have access to glass. Why or why not? And does the full moral status of an object, I'm convinced that there's an aspect of it, a sense to the referent in which the individual subject is in play, but to what extent do we then consider society as its own subjective force with its own autonomous boundaries to, and its own rights, as it were?
So,
words, do you want to answer this
one? Yeah, I can. I would like to address the idea that morally neutral object. Our argument isn't that every single thing is morally neutral. I think that there probably are some intrinsic features of guns and weapons and bombs that do make them obviously more prone towards bad uses, or is it? Yeah. But I don't know. I don't think Google Glass doesn't have any intrinsic features that necessarily make it morally.
Right. It's definitely.
Just to elaborate on that, I guess I may just be reiterating the point, but I mean, how many really positive uses can be produced from a nuclear weapon compared to how many positive uses can be produced from a product like Google Glass? Or
depends on who you ask.
Right, and it's okay. Well, that seems to be perhaps a more deeply rooted philosophical question. And also, when you ask, should autonomous people be able to have access to weapons and things like that? And I feel like that's, I don't want to be using different definitions of the word autonomous. So to be clear, I mean, autonomy, depending on who you ask again, right, could be defined as we said, self-governance or rational will. But with regard to how someone uses that rational will and whether or not how they use it determines its rationality at all is, again, a deeper question. But for things like guns and things that don't have the possibility or have a higher possibility to produce more adverse effects, let's suppose, than positive ones, it seems like certain preventative measures should be taken in that regard. But with regard to glass and the individual's autonomy, I guess what I'm saying is that they're kind of just different things, because one has potential for better.
So you want to make it like a qualitative distinction between glass and, for example, firearms, private firearms.
We define autonomy within the confines of this product, because our specific role is to analyze the potential problematic implications of this product, and I don't think it's our role necessarily to go on and apply our definition of autonomy to a wide range of, you know, products and devices.
Okay, that brings us to the Q&A. Thank you very much. Now we have some time for the judges to provide you with some feedback. What's that?
You want to start over there?
Greg, you want to start with
feedback? I haven't gotten to start yet. All right. First of all, gentlemen, thank you. Nice work.
Thank you.
Let's start with what I really liked. First of all, I like that you broke the presentation down into the requisite categories. Start judging a little bit easier based on the boxes we have to fill in. Seriously though, an outline is appreciated. Although I would say maybe a little bit more of a tell them what you're going to tell them at the beginning. Like just a clear, this is our outline. There was a stating of the topic and the problem, and then we kind of jumped right in. I would have liked to have something a little bit clearer to sink my teeth into. That's just an opinion. On Rory, psychologist. We should switch to philosophy, brother. Join Spencer. What's that?
Actually did. Since the release of this,
Google Glass pushed me over the edge.
A philosopher, of course, because I could say that they should all go to law school.
Yeah, but
my plan, actually.
Well, you have to make money, so philosophy. So where's the money then? Jokes. I really appreciated the ethics portion of this presentation, because I thought you guys really did what you were asked to do, which was give a presentation not on business per se. I'm trying to think of a little handout they gave us, but business ethics in particular. Okay, so the framework, and then the justification, and then dealing with counterexamples. Well done on that. And my only pushback was just kind of some of the stuff that I asked at the end. I think that to make the accusation, to encourage the watchdog organization to rubber stamp Google Glass, because any reason not to would be morally arbitrary because it's already out there. And then to kind of whip up in the bowl of autonomy these other moral distinctions. We've already talked about, there's nothing intrinsic in an object itself. It's all the intention of the human subject. But then to come back and say, well, some objects are, obviously have a higher level of design, so there is something more essentially intrinsic there, in kind of an Aristotelian sense, that there's, there's a use to this that is more common than not. And that's why I was kind of trying to hit on the whole, you know, societal consensus bit too. But anyway, I thought you guys answered those questions well. I'd like to hear a little bit more of that from the presentation, but overall, very good.
I have to tell you, I am wowed, and I don't get wowed easily here. For 9 years, two sophomores, a freshman, and a junior. You guys perform at a level that a lot of the graduate students, the MBAs, should aspire to. And I don't say that easily. I'm a horrible grader, and that comes from having been a professor at one point. Seriously, I was very, very impressed. This was a very, very strong team. All of you stood your ground, you present well, you're very poised. Your graphics, unfortunately, that first thing failed, and that might have gone to the issue that you just raised as to things not being clear. The graphic might have given us some visual clarity at the same time. I was very, very impressed by this. I think where I was pushing you is the issue of, since I deal with cases, which means that the interactions between human beings have failed, or they've broken down, or one person has been abusive to another in the workplace, all I keep thinking is, wow, if this gets implemented on a broad scale, this may tremendously change, from an anthropomorphic sense, how people relate to each other once that glass is on, you know?
Right.
You can't let that word slip out of your mouth, but if it's being taped and it becomes much more ubiquitous to do that in terms of creating history. So that's a fact, you know, those issues I think are very, very fascinating. I think this is a much more difficult issue than it appears on first glance, and I was very impressed. I don't think I have the right to expect you to be lawyers in terms of understanding the doctrines of the right of privacy, which is a what's called the penumbra anyway, constitutionally. And if you ask John Roberts and Sam Alito, they'll tell you it doesn't exist at all. Never mind, Scalia. So there are other people who believe that it does exist. But I thought you did a very, very sophisticated job on the philosophical and the ethical aspects. And that those are, I think, typically more difficult for undergraduates to address than things that are much more concrete. The issues that you focused on were very thought-provoking and therefore more difficult than I think you handled yourself.
Thank you.
So, first of all, you get high marks for taking notes on feedback. The first team to do that, which if you get feedback, you want to know what else you can get better, right?
Right.
So, I'll give you the praise feedback and the developmental feedback, like everybody else has done in one fell swoop. So I thought giving a demo of the product in the beginning was a good idea. For the uninitiated, might just not know, right? Despite the technical challenge. So it was a risk worth taking, I thought. And I liked the history of computing and culminating with Google Glass. And, you know, really pulled it all together. You realize, yeah, this is just another computer device thing, right? It's not. It's just an evolution. That's what I was left with. The PowerPoint presentation was generally very good and it kept my attention, so that was excellent. I thought on the privacy side, the plain view kind of, you know what I mean, doctrine you were pushing, I like that. They have no privacy expectation or right necessarily, and something's right out in the open. They don't need to be hiding it. Kind of felt like, though, and I think it came out in the questioning, what about the situation like the physician's office or the, you know, the place where maybe there is an expectation of privacy. I like the, you know, I like the point that I think you made it, this, the autonomy, and people have to use any device, anything, morally and ethically. And I like the chair analogy. It might have been a better one to make. Don't know, haven't thought that much about it. But I like giving an analogy, right, in a story, and it makes people think and say, yeah, well, we don't have that expectation for that thing, so why are we putting on this? What's so different about it? And maybe you could have closed it by saying, using a closer analogous thing than a chair, you know, maybe a video camera. Say, we don't put those restrictions on that, why would we put it on this? It's not that much different. Right? That's how I would have argued it. But I did like using an analogy. That was excellent. I think the one challenge I had was, it didn't come out until the questioning, that your recommendation about the light coming on and then saying maybe you should have a sliding shade or screen, that didn't come out until the questioning to me. So maybe you're making it clear to me, I just didn't record it, but it could have been more hammered home that that's your recommendation. I like the beta test argument that Google's doing this to really bring out the problems and address them. I mean, that was supportive and I think supportive of your position. And then the arguing the benefits outweigh the detriments, that was good, it was a good idea. I would have liked more examples. Give one example of the surgeon or whatever, but or the patient in the hospital. I'd like some more examples, but I thought that was a good idea to go down that path. Look, I mean, you can say what you want about this, but there's some real benefits here that may very well outweigh all these detriments. So, good job.
Thank you.
I also thought you did a really great job. I liked your presentation. I thought it was very clean and clear and focused. Like they said, the way that you broke it up into the different areas made it easy to follow. Thought you handled the technology issue well, but I've been a trainer for years and sometimes it just happens no matter how much you prepare. But you have to be prepared to go on without it, and didn't really let that get to you, so that was good. I thought that you all spoke very well without many notes, and it's clear that you were all very familiar with this topic and this product, and you all spoke very easily about it off the cuff. So I thought you were very prepared, and that was apparent. You made really clear points on each of the topics, spoke to the anticipated dissent, which obviously the big one is privacy. I was kind of concerned at the beginning about the distraction issue with the driving, but you covered that in his, after his question, so that did clear it up, at least speaking to that. I thought, and you did in the questions afterwards, but I thought more comparison to the already existing cell phone, I think to me that spoke a lot to a lot of the issues too. Like this technology, and you did reiterate afterwards in the question, but this technology is not new other than the hands-free on your face option. Like most all of these things can already be done with your cell phone. So I thought you guys did a great job.
Thank you.
I did too. I would say I'm not picking on you, Luke. I had a hard time hearing you. And it could be that I was right here rather than right there. So if you were pitching this, say you were pitching this in a low to a venture capitalist or some group like that, you gotta make sure that everybody, so I'm gonna say, they're this way and I'm here. I really had a little hard time. I wanted to say speak up louder that I could understand. And I agree on the presentation and all of that. I really do, having done lots of presentations with people who are going to give you money or get behind you on things, be very careful with those videos. Really make sure, because that's where somebody could get us. You know, just, you did a great job, but I'm just saying, think of it that way. If this was a real job, somebody might say, well, you should have had that, been more prepared. I mean, really take care of that, whether it's, and I know everybody said it was, you did a well job, good job, but just think about it. You were getting paid. If somebody's paying you, they don't want to see that happen. So really test it out. Or don't use YouTube. Don't use YouTube, use something else.
Yeah. Okay, well that ends the feedback session. We want to thank you again. Thank you for being with us. We sure appreciate that. And the judges will now complete the forms, but you're welcome to stick around and visit. And